Dear Mr. Ferdentrup, and welcome to those of you who come from the Ukraine, Belarus, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to start by thanking Rebecca Harms and also apologising. Thank you for the invitation. I'm sorry I'm a little late. By way of explanation, on the Thursday before the Strasbourg plenary, we always have the Conference of Presidents and we prepare for the plenary. It's been a difficult morning. As you know, group leaders are a difficult bunch of people. I was one for 7.5 years, so I know what I'm talking about. That's why I'm late, and I'm sorry. So thank you very much, Rebecca, once again. Von Joppe, Michel Rivasi, I think I saw you a moment ago, yes? Your Leinen, Sir Papietikainen. They have been organising today's event, others with them, I know. It's taking part as part of the European Week. Also, with the help of the institution in Dortmund. We have met today in the European Parliament to discuss the meltdown in Chernobyl that took place 30 years ago, on 26th of April, 1986. There was a complete meltdown in that reactor. It wasn't only one of the greatest technological disasters of the 20th century, it was also a tragedy with disastrous consequences. And I think the 26th of April is a day that we must remember. Almost everybody remembers where they were when they heard that news. And they remember the thoughts that went through their head when they heard it. I still feel very personally moved by it. I was a young husband. My wife was heavily pregnant. We were in Lower Saxony, in Lüneburg, to be precise. Yeah, your area. I was on the way to Bugum in Schleswig-Holstein. I had friends and acquaintances there, so we stopped off. My wife was pregnant with our first son, and we were very worried about it. We felt that we were very lucky. If we had been closer, who knows what would have become of our child. So I still feel very personally affected by that date. Not all of the details of the disaster have been clarified. We know that there were two explosions destroying four reactor blocks. Radioactive material was dispersed into the atmosphere across Russia, Belarus, and the Ukraine. They were areas that were particularly contaminated. There was a radioactive cloud that then reached Central Europe, and I think then further afield, and was very worrying to all of us. I was a mayor at the time, and we changed all of the sand in the children's playgrounds. We switched it over. We were told to do that. I still don't know whether it was the right thing to do. But as you can see, this is something that had a real impact on everyday life across Europe. The exact number of those who died who were injured in the disaster is controversial. We still don't have an exact figure. Perhaps we never will have that figure. In terms of the health consequences and the fatalities, there are varying estimates. Some say a few thousand. Some say 10,000, tens of thousands. Some say hundreds of thousands. But it is clear that nearly 300,000 people had to leave their homes and lose their homes. Communities were torn apart. regions became uninhabitable, the area of around Chernobyl continues to be very badly affected. The town of Pripyat, 30 years later, as we saw recently, remains a ghost town. And this is because of radiation, fears about radiation. Food from the regions was prohibited. And then there's a question of what you do with the ruin of Chernobyl, what do you do with the remains? It's very expensive to take the measures that need to be taken. There are measures currently being implemented which will be completed by 2017. It's costing over €1 billion. It's an enormous sum of money. The consequences of the disaster still haven't been fully understood. It's likely, of course, we know that Chernobyl wasn't the last accident. On the 11th of March 2011, we learnt of the earthquake and tsunami in the east of Japan, a natural disaster which then triggered the reactor accident at Fukushima. Once again, an unimaginable disaster. It unleashed an enormous amount of radioactive material contaminating the surrounding area. And it still raised questions that haven't been cleared up. For example, how much water leaked out? Over 150,000 people had to be evacuated out of the zone nearby. 97,000 still haven't returned. Radioactivity remains very high. 5 years later, one third of the region has been decontaminated. But in terms of the homes, the local water, experts think it will take decades to completely decontaminate that area. And the costs there, again, run to hundreds of billions. In the European Parliament, as legislators, we have to live with the fact that the decision to use nuclear power is not in the hands of the EU, it's in the hands of the member states. My homeland, Germany, as is well known, has decided to transition away from nuclear power. Other countries have decided that they will continue to use more nuclear power, build new reactors. So it's not the case that there is a consensus across Europe. There's very little consensus as to the present and future of nuclear power. And this morning in the newspapers, I now hear that in the Netherlands, democracy has won because they don't want to conclude an association agreement with the Ukraine. The turnout was 32%. Well, if you have a 32% turnout in an election, I think we all think that's a disastrous result from the election. The idea that a 32% turnout is a victory for democracy is peculiar. We need to think what we're talking about, because 60% of 32%, to my mind, is about 10% of the population, which suggests that 90% of the population thought something rather different about that referendum. I'm saying that because there are those who are in favour of pushing for more nationalisation. They're wrong. There are areas where we don't need less power in the EU, but actually rather more, and that applies in particular when it comes to energy policy. Nuclear clouds don't recognise national borders. They affect people everywhere. And the risks are not equally dispersed either. I live in a border area, that's my constituency, around Aachen. We're quite close to Tihange, the Belgian nuclear power station. It's 22 kilometers from the border, and I'm another 17 kilometers from the border on the other side. So I'm aware of the fears that people have about nuclear power. For many years, I was mayor of a town which was very close to the Yuli Nuclear Research Center, so I know what I'm talking about when it comes to the risks posed by nuclear power. At a European level, Fukushima was taken as a trigger to put the nuclear reactors through a stress test. Member states are obliged to shoulder their responsibilities in this area and to introduce better safety and environmental standards to nuclear power if they are going to use nuclear power. And that means that we have to be in contact with the Belgian state about that, for example. When it comes to learning the lessons of Fukushima and Chernobyl, this is something which is as relevant today as it was 55 years ago or 30 years ago. And I hope that your event today will help to make a contribution to raising awareness of the hazards that remain with us. We have a group leader with us here who's been a pioneer of the anti-nuclear movement. She's a very important group leader in the Parliament. For 30 years, longer, perhaps 40 years, she has fought tirelessly. And I don't think she's likely to give up on ensuring that this is an honourable and a beneficial struggle for the better. Thank you.
Ja, vielen Dank.
Thank you very much, President Schulz. He said himself that this is a very important event, but he needs to get to a very important event, the Conference of Presidents, to prepare for plenary next week. Perhaps the plenary session afterwards, the one that's going to take place in Brussels, is something that perhaps I'd suggest, that because we will have the actual 30th anniversary fall during that week, that we make sure that we try to get that on the agenda. And that resolution would also focus on what we're trying to concentrate on here, and that's learning the lessons from Chernobyl. I think it's something that's underestimated. It's not considered sufficiently when we think about everything that we learn, knowledge and science. I think we talk about scientific discoveries, we'll talk about Chernobyl and the scientific part of that, but we can see that there's a huge amount of scientific work that has been done surrounding this, but that no one really looks at. However, that does merit critical attention so that we can really work out how research, especially when it comes to the health consequences, how that can best be continued. Having said that, I would like to briefly say something about this conference today. You've got the programme that's working together with the IBB, who are very present here, and I think that's excellent in terms of our cooperation. And the program's actually been divided into two parts. One part is looking at witness reports. Those witnesses will help us to digest what this disaster really means 30 years afterwards, not what it was, but what it continues to be. And I think that's a very important part, and I'm very pleased that as part of this part, we've got Katia Petroska, who's a German-Ukrainian writer, with us here today. And I'm very pleased because as a young woman, before it was even clear that she was going to be a writer, she began as a young woman to think about this disaster. And in a second part, We've planned to have a debate about the health aspects of Chernobyl and the fallout. And we've invited Ian Fairley, the British scientist. On the 20th anniversary of the disaster, I worked together with Ian Fairley on a report about the people who had been affected and the fatalities and health effects that were due to this disaster. It was quite controversial at the time because we decided, in order to make sure that it couldn't be discredited, that we would only use peer-reviewed material as the basis of our report. And I'd have to thank Vienna and Global 2000, that organisation deserves my gratitude, because on the 30th anniversary of Chernobyl, they've actually updated that version of the report, and that's also going to be presented by Ian Fairley today. Now, the third part of the conference is going to look at nuclear power today, especially in the east, in Ukraine, because even if that's quite controversial, even in Ukraine, well, I am convinced that we really need to learn these lessons from Chernobyl, and we need to look at this constant struggle against the consequences, and that means that we can't continue with this nuclear nightmare that's been affecting these people in such a way for at least half a century now. I myself would like to thank the Pen Club today, because it doesn't exist anymore, but I think 30 years ago, in 1988, well, they invited me to Moscow and to Kiev. There were writers, it was this, and it's thanks to the writers from the Soviet Pen Club that, and it's thanks to them that since 1988 I've had a special relationship with Ukraine, with Russia, with Belarus. And this is because these writers at the time, in the time of perestroika, they thought that it would be good if those who were against nuclear power, the anti-nuclear movement, were also invited to this region around Chernobyl, this exclusion zone, and also then going to Kiev and Moscow, they could be invited to the first public event, as it were, with this writers' organization, and then they could report on what they saw. Now, this is a story with lots of different wide-reaching consequences, because I don't just deal with Chernobyl, although I still continue to do so. I also look at nuclear energy in the eastern half of the continent, but also the former Soviet Union, and also since 1988 I've been looking at all of these regions, but there's no longer the Soviet Union in place, and also we can see that now we're seeing a new escalation between these nations, unfortunately, towards the east of our continent. At the moment, we'd like to focus on what we have in common. These three countries, Ukraine, Russia, and Belarus, and what they need to now tackle, and that's the consequences. In all walks of life, also in politics, there are many things that happen, but there are always events that are different, that affect you differently, that really get deep into your heart and your mind. And such an experience was indeed my experience in 1988, 2 years after this disaster and my opportunity to visit Chernobyl. I spent one day in that zone. I spoke with experts scientists there. I got to know cleaning ladies just by chance who at the time had been working in the nuclear power plant that had already been commissioned. I was also speaking to soldiers from the Red Army as we were led out of the zone. We were taken to Kiev and they couldn't understand that suddenly there were German citizens that they'd met on the bus that they'd stopped on the road to Kiev. And therefore these discussions, well, what did they really show me? Well, they showed me that after this disaster, after this happened, that people stood up to that challenge of tackling the impact. They didn't really know how hazardous this was. They grasped pretty quickly that this wouldn't be able to be brought under control without them acting. However, they did little by little realize that this war, they have to call this a battle, a war, that this battle to get this under control was just one battle in the war. They knew that they would be able to control the impact in the sense that they could extinguish the fire to try to limit contamination, but they also knew that they were going to fall victim to this war. That was the experience that we saw time and time again, and there was far too little information about this. And then whoever was involved in that struggle, that battle, because they wanted to guarantee the survival of humanity, well then that meant that they weren't going to emerge from this battle safe and sound themselves. And I think that was the worst, most significant experience that we saw. And now I think it's been observed best by people from the region. The fact now that they're seeing that they're children have very slim chances now. They can't guarantee what they'd really like to guarantee for their children. That is a healthy life, one of welfare and well-being. Svetlana Alexandrovna, the Nobel Prize winner, is someone who I'd like to congratulate on behalf of everyone here for getting the Nobel Prize for Literature. So, well done.
Sie hat mit
together with her work on what happened in the Soviet Union, in Belarus, in Russia, in Ukraine over the previous decades, has contributed a great deal to the fact that today we can understand what happened in Eastern Europe a little bit better. But also with her book about Chernobyl, she also allowed us to address a disaster. An old woman who I met in Chernobyl in one of the villages, she'd gone back to the exclusion zone, and in 1988 she said that before the disaster, the world in which she lived was divided into two parts. There was the part before the major war of the fatherland and the part afterwards. And these two models in time, well, that was possible for that war, but it isn't possible for the disaster. There's a time before it, but there's no post-Chernobyl era. There's just now. So this continues today. And Martin Schulz said this quite correctly, that we're dealing with two disasters that we aren't able to deal with. So Chernobyl and also Fukushima. And our task now, because we know as humanity, that we're not up to this challenge. I think therefore our task, in my view, is to find a way out of this nuclear era, to leave this nuclear power era. And I think we need to contribute to this with our conference today. And I'd like to thank IBB for their excellent idea to hold this event. And I'd also, well, I don't want to neglect the IBB, but I'd now give the floor to Peter Junger Venhub. I'm very pleased that we're finally able to get to know one another up here on the podium.
Invitation, and of course, very thanks to Mr. Schulz. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the invitation and the opportunity to have an open discussion today. We express also our deepest gratitude to Mr. Schulz for realizing that the European Parliament has taken the European Action Weeks under its patronage. The nuclear fallout in Chernobyl affects all European countries, as the radioactive clouds don't stop at national borders. Therefore, as you tell it, we need European answers and solutions. Please let me say some words with regards to the European Action Weeks for a future after Chernobyl and Fukushima. Our friends, and they are here, our partners are the liquidators. They worked on the reactor of Chernobyl in the year 1986 to 1989. They sacrificed their health to save the rest of us. More than, so our information, 850 people, mainly soldiers, firemen, policemen, engineers, nurses, pilots, were on duty between 1986 and 1989. They didn't know the consequences the work would have for their health. Of these 850,000 liquidators, around 550,000 lived in the Ukraine and 120,000 in Belarus. They formed themselves in organizations to fight for social benefit and medical support. About 300,000 Approximately 300,000 of these liquidators have died until now, and all the others, 550,000, are retired. Nowadays, they still fight for their pensions and especially for medical support. However, this is a fight against windmills, as current national problem seems to be more urgent than supporting the liquidators. Liquidators are faced indifference and often ask, what do you want? How can you still ask for support when we are facing bigger problems in our country? Our question is, how can support look like today? We see only one option, and that is to support the liquidators to support themselves. Therefore, the question is there a possibility for the European Union to fund a program launching to social enterprises? The Ukraine legislation offers a tax reduction for companies which hire handicapped employees or companies which are run by handicapped people themselves. However, it is not possible to start up a business without initial funding. Is it possible for the European Union to create a fund which help social startups, and that this fund can be given to these companies, social companies, quickly and unbureaucratically? The heart and the soul of the European Action Weeks are the people who can tell their story at first hand, who can tell us what happened in Chernobyl and Fukushima. in more than 200 cities and more than 350 events all over Europe, these people tell us about their fate. The events are held in churches, in schools, for firemen and other people. On April the 25th, we will light candles all together in all the cities to remind ourselves of the catastrophes of Chernobyl and Fukushima. All together with one question and one goal, to shift our society to a more sustainable energy policy, to a sustainable production cycle and a sustainable lifestyle. We don't want to live in Europe endangered with nuclear power. European Action Weeks are realized to be a voluntary dedication of many initiatives all over Europe. They are partly funded by the Protestant Church of Westphalia and the Foundation of Environment and Development in North Rhine-Westphalia. The European Action Weeks would not be possible without the International Chernobyl Network, a network of initiatives all over Europe and the Ukraine and Belarus. In the early 90s, initiatives have formed in all European countries, which organized summer camps for children and realized projects in Belarus and in the Ukraine with local partners. More than 1 million children were given the chance to visit West Europe and stay with families in these countries. There is a lot of cooperation between the initiatives with respect to healthcare, education, ecological products of food, and any more. There are still more than 100 active people in this movement all over Europe and especially in Italy. Please let me put your attention to one circumstance we cannot understand. In England, there are more than 100 initiatives inviting children and teenagers from areas directly influenced by Chernobyl. Their parents pay for the travel expenses, accommodation, and for the program. They get help by sponsors, which they acquire themselves. However, they do have to pay 100 euro for every visa for every child. We know that England is not in the Schengen area. Nevertheless, the circumstance it is a circumstance which do not agree, so our view, with the freedom and liberality of Europe. Please bring this fact up in a conversation with your British colleagues. Mr. Schulz told us in his letter he wrote to us that the European Parliament is concerned about the safety of nuclear power plants. We strongly agree, especially considering the new threat. We are come here together in Brussels 2 weeks after the terror attack of this city. Can you rule out that such a threat of a terroristic attack against can't happen against or very close to a nuclear power plant? How can reactors still be considered to go on grid, also partly cracked like Tihange? Why is it possible for power plant operators not to inform the public on disturbance like it happened in Fessenheim? What does the European Parliament do to convince each and every European country to phase out of the nuclear energy production? What does the European Parliament do to convince governments who currently do not operate nuclear power plants, but they are planning it for the future? How many catastrophes, how many casualties do we have to endure until there is a real change in the UN, in the European policy on the question of energy and nuclear power plants? So thank you very much for your attention. We are looking forward for the discussion. Thank you so much.
Thank you, and I invite Jo Leinen, colleague from S&D Group, and the speakers of the first panel.
So, vielen Dank, Rebecca.
Thank you very much, Rebecca, for chairing the first part of this wonderful event. I'd also like to wish you all a warm welcome and thank all of you who have travelled to come here today to the European Parliament in order to discuss what happened and also to look at what our objectives should be now and in the future. Like Rebecca, I'm a long-standing opponent of nuclear power. It's 40 years now since I took part in the protests against the nuclear power plant in Biel in the Upper Rhineland. I well remember the day of the disaster. I was an environment minister in my region of Germany in the Saarland. With Mr. Rivasi, we had a TV debate on French television because the radioactive cloud was apparently had stopped at the Franco-German border. That's what we were told. Our children had been kept at home, for example, but in France they were let out to play. And it was primetime TV that we were on. And we tried to break through this kind of wall of silence. There are still people who say that there's no such thing as climate change, and back then there were people who claimed that there was no radioactive cloud. Shortly before Chernobyl, Germany appointed its first environment minister in Bonn, Friedrich Zimmermann from Bavaria. I was on a TV debate on ZDF, and he said, it's 2,000 kilometres away, we don't have anything to do with that. And I and other people said, well, it might reach us. And a couple of days later, the radioactive cloud did reach us. And that minister, Helmut Kohl, and the chancellor had to react. Months later, this person was actually dismissed. And because it had been such a disaster, he turned a blind eye to what had happened. Anyway, that's what I have to say by way of introduction. And there are lots of anecdotes, some of them rather absurd. But of course, this was a very serious disaster that affected many people. And I know how many fears there were. There was a lot of rain in the days afterwards. People were concerned that they would be affected by the fallout. We have an excellent panel with us today. And I'll welcome them in the order that they're listed in the program. Katja Petrovskaya, a German-Ukrainian writer.
Steht ja einiges auch in den Unterlagen, was
our documents tell us something about what you have done. Alexander Ruchlia is the co-founder of the Rehabilitation and Creation Center. We met in my office. And I'm proud to say that in my town, there is a center for Chernobyl children. And every year, we have visitors of school children. I'd like to welcome Lyubov Negatina and Anatoly Gubariev. They have put together a history workshop about what happened and are involved in the sponsoring of social enterprises. We never hear so much German as we've been hearing this morning in the Parliament this morning. Normally we speak English.
Of this organization and of this event. Yeah, wir haben eine Stunde Zeit.
We have an hour. And perhaps I can give you 10 minutes each to make your presentations, and that will allow some time for questions and answers. Katja.
Guten Tag. Ich freue mich eigentlich.
Good morning. I'm pleased to be with you this morning. I'm a Russian-speaking Ukrainian, but today I'll be speaking German. Might seem a bit strange, but I'd like to say a few words in Russian because I know there are many Russian speakers with us.
It seems that it's a great honor to be present here today, and I'm grateful to Rebecca Harms for what she's doing for our countries, for all of us. And we all are bound by the feeling of a common disaster. And I'm going to try and read a very short message, my memories. And it's not as dramatic as the story of many of the people who are also present here today. I'm going to continue in German.
In das sprechen. Okay. Das andere ausmachen. Also, in Chernobyl gab es einen Knopf. Übrigens, ja, niemand.
Nobody knows who pressed the button. In Chernobyl, there was just one button to press. That's one of the most interesting stories.
Meine eigene Geschichte.
My own story was really at the sidelines of the Chernobyl disaster. I wasn't a victim, but everything that happened in Chernobyl is my story too. Contaminated villages, people who were ill or were killed, many who lost their home. Children were born with illnesses and will become ill. This is part of my homeland, with its rivers and fields and forests, which will remain contaminated forever. I wasn't affected, unlike hundreds of thousands of other people. In 3 weeks' time, we will see the 30th anniversary of the Chernobyl disaster. As Rebecca said, it's not really the right anniversary because this disaster has no past. Its consequences will last beyond our lifespan. It affects our idea of time and of figures. It will continue to develop with consequences that even scientists don't know. Now we're seeing the building of a second sarcophagus. It's one of the largest buildings in Europe, as high as a pyramid. It's supposed to last 100 years, but then it would have to become 60 times as old as the Egyptian pyramids to keep back the radiation over thousands of years to come. It would have to become 300,000 years old. Even scientists obviously often give up on figures in this field and just say forever. It's hard to tell you about Chernobyl to get the ideas across. The figures are unimaginable. The pictures are hard to understand. There are two types of pictures you can think of. Some think of it as the Jurassic Park of the Soviet Union, with houses which have been overgrown with bushes, children born with birth defects. But all of these pictures can't really reflect the threat of Chernobyl. In those days in Chernobyl, my childhood ended. I was 16. I got into the train on my own and headed for Moscow. I thought that that would be for a certain period of time. It was forever. My home in Kiev was then 90 kilometers away from Chernobyl. I was in a central school. The accident happened on a Friday night. On Saturday, there were rumors at school, and lots of children had parents in high office. Some children had been woken in the night. There was an army doctor and a number of civil servants, for example. There was a poet and song evening, and we stayed late. There was a storm outside. We had a premonition as though it was a departure. We went home in the rain. The rain wasn't radioactive at that stage. Today, we don't remember the compulsory military lessons or the constant fears of war at the time. We could take Kalashnikovs apart very quickly. We knew about all sorts of survival tactics. During a nuclear explosion, you have to lie down on the floor. We knew about a girl from Hiroshima who had tried to fight off her leukemia with methods it wouldn't help. We were pioneers. We had to be ready at all times. We were trained. But nobody was prepared, and nobody knew exactly what was to come. My parents listened to hostile radio, Voice of America, the BBC, and they learnt about the disaster quickly, but they weren't aware of the proportions and the consequences. A radioactive cloud sounded more surreal than something from outer space. 3 days after the accident, there were already several fatalities, and Prypych had been evacuated. Then there were the first official reports about technical difficulties at the nuclear reactor in Chernobyl. My parents understood. We people will be left on our own. There was no information. Close the window, don't go out for a walk. We weren't even told that much. When the wind came from the north, an acquaintance of my parents, a physicist, said, send the children away. I'll tell you all about it later. A hematologist then took out files and called all of his patients up. My parents didn't hesitate for a second. I should be sent away. But the reactors and the authorities wouldn't allow this. People could lose their jobs. On the 1st of May, people fled out onto the streets, and my parents took me to the station. I felt like I was a coward and a traitor, but I knew that what we were doing was better than to stay. When the half-empty train set off, I heard a march playing. It's something that would constantly be played on the loudspeakers when there were announcements from Moscow and a train heading to Moscow. This march had accompanied all wars. And I looked out of the train windows, and I looked at my parents. They looked very old to me. I don't know what I was thinking about. I was crying. I know exactly what they were thinking, though. Both of them were the children of times and wars, and that march that was played was a song of fate for them. We grew up in a time when people weren't aware of time. Brezhnev was going to live forever. The Volga would flow into the Caspian. Everything was stable. In 1984, the year of George Orwell's book, the year of the title, that was supposed to be the final year. In 1985, Gorbachev put in place his program to speed up economic growth. But that speeded up the disintegration of a broken country. And people thought that this was something that had been predicted. The Ukrainian word Chernobyl means bitterness. The third angel sounded the drums. That was a quote from a book. Flares burnt and the rivers flowed fast, and the name was meant bitterness, and the third part of the water became bitterness, and many people died because of the waters, because they had become bitter. The first days of May were early summer weather. Everybody was outside. Officially, there was still no information about the danger. Kiev was expecting international guests for an event. There was then panic, and there were rumors about thousands of people having been injured in one area. Have I run out of time? There were rumors about thousands of people having been injured in one area around the nuclear power station, children of party officials who were said to have been taken secretly to airports with gas masks. Then we were told that there was a threat to life in Kiev. The word evacuation came up, evacuation of children, like in a war. Within 24 hours, plane and flight tickets were made available and then sold out for different targets. There were thousands of mothers at Kiev airports trying to get their children out. One of my friends remembers that someone near her said, "This package won't fly. Nark and the grandma will send two children." People sent children out to Tashkent, for example, groups of children. One took just a small bag and an apple as all possessions. All of the trains, special trains, they were overcrowded. Mothers lay on the track in order to try to force them to take their children. Then they said that every adult who had a ticket would be allowed to take an unlimited number of children. They were crammed in at random into the train without a choice. You can see this in documentaries. You can see the trains crammed with pregnant children, pensioners, mothers with young children, many other children, and then you can see the other adults on the platforms. And then you can see the departure. Nobody actually switched off the recording. The adults remained. They had to work. On the 14th of May, 2.5 weeks after these events, the amount of radioactive iodine had halved, and then Gorbachev appeared on Soviet TV to give an announcement. My school was then evacuated. The remaining pupils were crowded onto buses. The cleaning lady of the school was crying constantly. We could write a whole book about the role of cleaning ladies through history. They're always there. Hundreds of buses left Kiev heading south. Only those who were the A-level stage had to stay. Why is radioactivity important if you have big school exams coming up? Kiev was soon free of children. No laughter, no children crying, no pregnant women. But there were fire engines driving up and down the streets, using hoses to clear away radioactive dust, even when it was raining. Much later, I found that the foundations in Pripyat had been relaid a few hours after my birth.
Vielleicht war diese Stadt mein Zwilling, denn unsere 30.
Perhaps this was my twin and has been dead for 30 years. It's a reason. Apologies.
Ja, liebe Katja.
Yes, dear Katja. Thank you very much for a very impressive report there, an emotional report as a witness of this disaster. Of course, it's really hard to describe how dramatic that must be for those who witnessed the evacuation of the villages and Kiev as well. And the lack of information, the misinformation, the manipulation that was seen from the official side in the first few days afterwards. It was extremely impressive there. Thank you very much we can really get a sense of how it still affects people 30 years afterwards. Alexander Richler has done a great deal for the children in the region around Chernobyl, so we'll like to invite him to take the floor. Please go ahead.
Спасибо.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I am very grateful for this opportunity to talk to you about this important international Belarusian-German project. This is a children's health center called Nadezhda, or Hope, which is an important facility for the children who have suffered as a result of this catastrophe. The Chernobyl disaster in 1986 was very tragic. On the other hand, it was an important milestone for the development of humankind. Humans saw that they had in their hands an instrument to produce energy that they were not able yet to use in a perfect way, and it forced humanity to look for alternative sources of energy. And assessing the scale of the tragedy at the nuclear reactor, we have come to understand that only together we would be able to resolve some of the environmental problems that affected not one country but many. Because of the meteorological conditions in Belarus at the time, because of the rains, because of the precipitation, Belarus was affected by 70% of the free radionuclides, and a quarter of the territory, 23%, were contaminated, and about one-fifth of the population actually resided in the contaminated areas. After the disaster in the areas that were affected, there were 2 million people residing, and out of them, over 500,000 children. The Chernobyl disaster happened in 1986, when we still lived under the USSR and the KPCC, and according to the ideology of the time, and we have heard this from Katy already, the tragedy was kept quiet, although the whole world already knew about it, and this was a crime against our own people, where level of radiation was many times higher than acceptable. There were demonstrations and meetings on the 1st of May. There was no information for the population. This created panic and fear. And of course, this affected the people very negatively. It affected their health. Immediately after the disaster, scientists from all over the world showed very active interest in studying the consequences together with the Belarusian scientists. And of course, it was important for all countries. But active cooperation became possible at the end of the 1980s, when these consequences were declassified. And we were working extremely actively with Germany and Japan on in the area of these studies. But we already heard from Mrs. Harms that we still have to continue learning about what happened with the consequences. And after the truth of Chernobyl became public and maps of contaminated areas were published, Belarus started its humanitarian cooperation with many countries of the world. Public initiatives were formed in Germany and other countries, and together with international public organizations, we started creating partnership organizations and initiatives in Belarus. Many of them still exist today. The main share of these organizations were helping children to rehabilitate their health abroad and to obtain help in Belarus. There were various projects, and they included handing out of food packages, care packages, providing healthcare facilities with medications, etc. In 1988-89, there were two Belarusian-German political, what we call crusades, in order to reach understanding we went to two pilgrimages, and during these pilgrimages, we discussed the consequences in providing help to the population, especially the children living in the affected areas. Specifically, we talked about what to do in Berlin a little bit later in 1990. And this conference in June 1990, we entered into a long-term agreement between Belarus and an organization in Belarus working with Chernobyl in Frankfurt, allowing our children to be rehabilitated abroad was extremely important, because our international partners were able to see and understand and feel who needs their help, because they saw these children with their own eyes. And at this very time, we established the Nadezhda Fund, and very soon in Minsk we signed a memorandum of understanding to create this children's health care, to bring about common understanding. And in November 1990, we created Lebanach Chernobyl Frankfurt am Main, which was created on the basis of the working group that already existed. And in November 1991, we created a public organization called Life After Chernobyl. And these two organizations, together with the Evangelical Church of Germany, and they started working on documentation in order to register. And the Belarusian state allowed us to have this partnership registered, the partnership Nadezhda, registered on the 28th of July, 92. In the Vereysky region of the district, rather, of the Minsk region, we were able to create this facility on the banks of a river. This is still the only private health facility with a share of state ownership. The state actually played a very important role in the creation of the center and gave us a lot of support. We would not have been able to create it without the state. There was a lot of debate whether the state would interfere with the project, whether there would be any barriers placed there by the state. But our experience has shown us that Nadezhda was a project that combined very successfully the cooperation between public organizations and governmental structures. It is noteworthy that this project is in full compliance with our national law on providing health facilities for children who are affected. There's parity between the state and the private structures in the support and the management of this project, or rather the Belarusian and German partners. It is divided half and half, and the share of the state is no higher than 25%. With regards to funding of the center, starting with 1992, we have raised 21 million euros from the Belarusian state, 11 million euros from our German participants, and 2 million euros from the Japan Children's Chernobyl Fund. And it was extremely helpful that we were able to get help from our German partners. We have been receiving very significant funding, especially from Gessen. Children's Chernobyl Fund of Japan was also taking a very important part. Although they had their own Chernobyl, the Fukushima tragedy, and the Children's Chernobyl Fund of Japan has been a long time a partner of Nadezhda and has been helping children who have undergone operations of the thyroid cancer, and we have offered. We have offered that we could probably do without their help now, but our Japanese partners said that they would not stop helping us after Fukushima, but they will help both their own children and ours. There is a center, Kuminasata Okinawa, in Japan, and starting with 2003 to 2006, the circle of our international friends has been growing, and now we work with more than 30 organizations from 12 countries. And this is happening because many partners have decided not to invite children abroad to their own countries, but to send them to Nadezhda, which is cheaper and more efficient. And many German organizations stopped to taking children to Germany, but instead they send them to Nadezhda. We have partners from a number of countries, including Ireland, Italy, Spain, Ukraine, etc. This is a very wide international network. And over the last years, the number of partners in Germany has grown. Many of them are now our permanent partners, and our interaction with them now goes beyond health. And we now have 8 organizations that have formed an association of friends of Nadezhda. And since July 2015, this organization is the single participant from the German side, which really goes a long way to facilitate our work with the German participants.
I need to finish then, so apologies.
I would like to say in conclusion that we're extremely grateful for your help, and to express my hope that this work will continue in the future. This is very relevant work. It still remains important, although sometimes Chernobyl is forgotten. Fukushima and Chernobyl are very important. We have in Tartanoma, there are problems everywhere, and I am categorically against nuclear power. I think we need to develop alternative sources of energy, and this is why Nadezhda is building its own photovoltaic panel, and we would like to provide energy, our own energy, from the sun, from other natural sources of energy. Thank you very much for your attention, and best wishes to everyone.
Yeah, wunderbar, Alex.
Yes, excellent, Alexander Richer. Thank you ever so much for this work. 30 years with the whole network. I'm sure many of them are here. You've been involved in the network for ever so long, and there are many different ways in which that is important. You're helping people, especially children in the region, and supporting them. So thank you very much for this work over all of that time. We've also got Negatina Lubov and Anatoly Gubirov, who have established a history workshop, and we're going to hear for them as witnesses from the time. So you have the floor.
Good afternoon, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am one of those 850,000 so-called liquidators at the Chernobyl power station who were taking immediate or rather direct part in the liquidation of this most horrific catastrophe that took place in 1986. So my colleagues are here in this room, the people who are also liquidating the consequences. And now are heads of public non-governmental organizations, and they're now involved in helping their colleagues who were also affected. I would like to give them a round of applause. Colleagues, can you please stand up? From our point of view, what is Chernobyl? From our point of view, it is not just a nuclear reactor that exploded, not just a shelter, not just a confinement that is being constructed. First of all, Chernobyl is people. It is hundreds of thousands of people. It's millions of people. And at the start of 2016 in Ukraine, there were almost 2 million people who had been affected by the law in Chernobyl. Out of them, 419,000 people were children, and 108,000 people were disabled because of Chernobyl. And the liquidators of the disaster, out of them, there are only 210,000 remaining. 54,000 of them are disabled. Their average age today is not much higher than 50 to 55 years. And these numbers tell us not only about the scale of the disaster, but also about the need to carry on with the projects of providing social and medical help to those who are affected. Because of the events in the east of our country, the funding of these programs has now been significantly cut. It's much lower than the actual need. And the main type of help is pensions, disability pensions, due to radiation exposure. 87% of disabled persons in Ukraine receive a minimal pension that is lower than 90 euros per month per person. Unfortunately, even these pensions are sometimes delayed, which forces people to file complaints with the court. Out of 47 countries, Ukraine takes fourth place with regards to non-compliance with decisions of the European Court of Human Rights. And the greatest number of them, 419, are to do with non-compliance by public authorities with decisions of national courts, including pension provisions for the liquidators of the Chernobyl disaster. With regards to all of the social programs in Ukraine, in 2016, it's been planned to allocate about 2 million hryvnia, which is about 33 euros per person per year. And in the Kharkov region, where I come from, we have more than 3,500 liquidators, disabled liquidators. And over the last 2 years, we have been joined by 2,200 of the liquidators of Chernobyl from the east of our country. And these temporarily replaced persons had not been provided for by the budget. And this is why these people were not able to get the medical and social help they needed. The state keeps cutting the services it provides and the benefits it provides. And then in turn, it should provide social and medical packages for these people. And on behalf of Chernobyl liquidators, I would like to express our huge gratitude to the European community for the invaluable help that we receive from Ukraine receives from European countries, and I would like to request that you continue your providing your help in order to relieve the very difficult conditions of our disabled persons and children. For a number of years, there have been international programs to monitor the situation. Based on Japan's experience, we know that the worst consequences begin 40 years after the disaster. This is why it is important to keep monitoring the situation. And international organizations, medical, charitable organizations also help these categories of people. And 30 years later, even, we need this help. We still need this help. In turn, we do everything we can in order to improve the lives of the people who were affected by the Chernobyl disaster. But unfortunately, because there's a lack of communication between the state and our public organizations, the efficiency of our work is much lower than it could have been. And we continue to work on communications. We continue to work on confidence building with the government. We work very actively in the field, which my colleague will tell you about. And a few words to conclude. Based on our experience from Chernobyl and Fukushima, we can see that we have not learned very much, either in Ukraine or in other countries. And we need to fight for our lives, for the future of our children and grandchildren. We need to fight for the survival of the whole humankind. Chernobyl is not over, even 30 years later. It will not be over in the coming years. Chernobyl and its consequences, unfortunately, are here to stay for centuries. Thank you.
Ja, vielen herzlichen Dank.
Yes, thank you, Anatoly Mariev. 100,000 invalids or the liquidators who were active in this huge amount of injustice. We don't see much being done at all for all those people. And I think this call for the project to continue is right. You need the medical and social support for these people, and this needs to be given. And we're going to make this visible in the parliament. So I'd like to invite the next speaker to give their contribution.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends and colleagues, given that we have already touched the issue of social standards for disabled persons, especially for those who have suffered that after the Chernobyl disaster, as of 2014, IBB Dortmund, together with the Kharkiv Public Organization at our Chernobyl workshop, launched a project in order to increase the amount of assistance given to the disabled people. We were also helped by the project and the Action for Humans. That was the first joint project where disabled people who became disabled after the Chernobyl disaster and other disasters. Actually, there is very little difference when it comes to disabled people. It doesn't matter how they've become disabled. It's a common problem. It's a common issue which affects all of the disabled people. So the liquidators who have become disabled, they want to be useful to the society. And in order for them to implement their capacity is hinged on their right to work. And that's where our social enterprise kicks in. We analyze the possibility to establish this organization for disabled people, and we have drafted 10 business plans for the Kharkiv and Dnipropetrovsk regions. Why did we choose these two regions? We did that because, given what is happening in our country as of 2014, the number of people who have become disabled in the Kharkiv region has increased by 8%, and in the Dnipropetrovsk region almost by 5%. This increase is due to the displaced persons from the military conflict in the East, and also including those people who became disabled because of that conflict. And it's not just those people who are involved in the anti-terrorist operation, but it also are those who are civilians but happen to be in that place. So all of them are still capable of working, and they want to realize their capacities. They want to realize themselves through their right to work. And today in Dnipropetrovsk region, we have about 38% people who can work. In the Kharkiv region, it's a bit more. It's around 43%. So what is important here is that people who have become disabled, they continue working even when they are of retirement age. Why is it happening? It is because the implementation of the right to work is a social component. And disabled people in Ukraine can go two ways. They can either find a job using a state finding job agency, or they could do it via the enterprises where they used to work. Unfortunately, our state service is not very efficient. In 2015, for one vacancy that was given by the state service, they had 12 applicants for each new job. And at the beginning of 2016, the numbers are that 16 applicants are competing for one job. So disabled people are in a very disadvantageous position so that they could find a job. In Ukraine, however, theoretically at least, there is some support on the part of the state to non-government organizations. For instance, they could levy some taxes and they could also offer some benefits. So, for instance, if you look at the chart on the slide, you will see that when it comes to tax benefits, it affects that is also the tax exemption and also new jobs for disabled people specifically. But this chart also shows that it affects only 5.4%. And this is what the state does for social security of the disabled. The rest comes from the enterprise. If the enterprise has managed to survive for more than 12 months with no losses, only then it can apply for these benefits. So in other words, this is what people earn themselves, and there are no subsidies from the state. In Ukraine, there is a law which stipulates that an enterprise which has more than 8 personnel should also have a job or create a job for disabled people. If the number of employees is about 25%, it should be at least one position, and if it's more than 25, then it should be two. However, unfortunately, about 40% of the enterprises do not comply with this regulation. And as a result, the Social Protection Foundation could theoretically impose some fines, but unfortunately there is no way to obtain the money. And even when money is obtained this way, still it cannot be used to create new jobs. But if you look at the enterprises, then on average in Ukraine, on an annual basis, about 900 million hryvnias could be accumulated to create new jobs. But again, in accordance with our legislation, this amount can be given to an enterprise that has been around for at least 12 months. In other words, not for new startups. And the key problem here for those enterprises is to create this kind of cushion. And given the actual economic situation in Ukraine, the enterprises are doing their most not to pay any fine, even when it's imposed, or to dodge them. However, this Disabled Protection Foundation, even given all the economic hardships we go through, managed to gain some profit. Even 2014 was finished with some profit, so which shows that these enterprises are supporting not just disabled people, but are also maintaining those social facilities that have been established at the above-mentioned enterprises. Within our project, only one organization dared to register this social enterprise based on one of the 10 draft business plans that I've mentioned, because it's not so easy to register. And the problem also is related to the lack of startup capital. And for the first project, the major funds were given by the enterprise itself, and we are also looking for sponsors under the auspices of other projects. However, there is a successful approach that has been already outlined, and we know it from experience that has been given to us by our German counterparts. This experience shows that these kind of enterprises could be quite successful on an open labor market, and the key to success is based on 3 K's. Or 3 C's, actually. The 3 C's are what we need. And they are as follows: compensation of disadvantages, access to capital for the founders of social firms, and then consulting and transfer of know-how. These 3 C's, when it comes to Ukraine, have been implemented only at the level of the first C, compensation of disadvantages, and I'm referring to the state implementation level. So the other 2 C's are still lacking, but that's what we need the most, and that's why, against the backdrop of our economic instability in Ukraine, when we know that our leadership is not going to establish social funds like this, we would like to ask for assistance from international donors, including the European Union, so that perhaps there could be a program launched to provide social startup capital for enterprises to establish jobs and start projects for disabled people. And also, perhaps those experiences that have been gained here in Europe could help us in establishing enterprises like this, which could give a boost to the actual capacity of our NGOs. And that would also help the Ukrainian budget, per se. And we are certain that if we launch this pilot project, we could hope for the best at the legislation level as well. And just one more thing in conclusion. We have conducted a research, and there are printouts of this research that we conducted by the National Assembly of Disabled People. And here you can find all the information that is related to social enterprises in Ukraine. Thank you once again for your attention and your understanding.
Thank you very much for that excellent work to help disabled people who have disabilities following the Chernobyl disaster and then following other disasters as well. We have just a few minutes left for a couple of comments. I'm pleased to see that we have colleagues with us who might want to introduce themselves and make a comment or put a question. In 5 minutes' time, we're going to move on to the next section. You have the floor.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm Petras Auštrevičius. I'm a member of European Parliament coming from Lithuania, a country which was under the impact of Chernobyl disaster for a certain period of time and remains some areas still polluted. Well, in fact, learning the lesson of Chernobyl, and especially for Belarus, a country which probably paid a very high price, I wonder, listening to Mr. Lukashenko, who is about to build a new nuclear power station in Belarus, in Ostravets, close to our border, and he proclaimed that the Russian-designed nuclear power station will be the cheapest one of this kind in the world. I wonder, if you built the cheapest one, what kind of a security and safety measures you might guarantee at that station, since will be no casing, above the nuclear power station. It's a kind of normal in Russia because it's a Russian design. So my question is, I mean, what should be done? And is there anything left might be done in order to bring that project under the public scrutiny and response from Belarusian people, because we have the moral right, I mean, to say no to those projects.
Yeah, thank you very much. Lithuania, of course, was affected as well. And some people don't learn or don't want to learn. And the cheapest nuclear power station cannot be the best, that's for sure.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm Aleš Peterle from Slovenia, member of EPP. Здравствуйте, дорогие друзья.
Hello, dear friends from Belarus. Thank you so much for everything you have told us here today.
It occurred that when it happened, the equipment of Yugoslav army did not find any radiation, you know, because the equipment was calibrated to atomic attack. So the phenomena was absent, you know, on behalf of the science, let's say so. Then when I followed the TV report from Belgrade television, somebody said, this will not affect Slovenia because the winds blow from the west to the east. But the cloud appeared in Slovenia one day later. Then I would like to promote a little bit my government. In Slovenia, the Greens were the first European party which was part of the government. And we agreed to close the nuclear power plant Krško, the only one we had. But if there something happens, we can all leave Slovenia to somewhere, you know? So I don't accept statistical argument that it happens only here and there and it is very safe. Once it happens, we are very weak, very vulnerable, confused, and so on. We saw what happened in Chernobyl. We also saw what happened in Fukushima, where the technology was different. But the other things were different as well. So I think that we have really to learn something of that. And I would like to mention one more fact. It's not that far that we had terrorist attack in Brussels, and there were some news also about the possibility that something was undertaken also or could be undertaken as far as atomic plants are concerned. And I think that this fact also should be considered or reconsidered when we speak about the use of atomic energy or on building new nuclear power plants. Thank you for your attention.
Yeah, vielen Dank für diese beiden Statements.
Thank you very much for those two statements. And also those urges that we should learn from the disaster. I'd like to thank this excellent panel, and can we once again have a round of applause?
And je prie alors mon collègue Michel Rivasi.
And I'd like to ask my colleague Michel Rivasi to chair the next session and to address all the issues to do with health. Thank you. And we'll press on with the session on health.
Donc, nous allons, attaquer le...
So we're going to make a start with the second section, which is about the health impact. There are some things that are always the same when it comes to nuclear power, and that's the extent of the misinformation out there. We have heard from witnesses that there is a lot of misinformation about what actually happened with the radioactive cloud from Chernobyl, or in the case of Fukushima, with the reality of the cloud from the nuclear power station. People didn't know what was happening and when it happened. They only found out later. I'd like to say something myself. I decided when Chernobyl happened that I would go into politics. That's why I came into politics. In France, at the time of the accident, we had a health ministry, a home office ministry, together. They said, this cloud isn't going to cross the French border. I was in the south of Drone, and I was getting information from Italy and from Germany, and they were saying that people were taking measures. We heard from Jolainen about this a moment ago. We were on a TV program run by Michel Boulak, and we heard the German and the French position. And there, scientists were sounding the alarm. We decided to create the first independent laboratory to measure radioactivity called CRIRAC. And when we got hold of the apparatus and we did the testing, we analyzed it. We analyzed water, the ground, and the milk, and then we published the lies about Chernobyl in the press. Times when France had lied to the people of France, no measures had been taken to protect children. And in particular, in Corsica, for example, where people practiced subsistence farming, people had eaten very significant doses of radioactive food. The laboratory is still working. It's completely independent from the nuclear lobby, and that's made it possible to speak out about that lie by the French state. They didn't want to alarm the French population when it came to the cloud from Chernobyl. But it went very far, because even the agriculture minister said that France had been completely spared by this cloud, and then 20 years later, the state recognized that, in fact, we were affected by Chernobyl. 20 years, that's how long it took for France to recognize, given the scale of the accident. You can imagine the effect of that kind of misinformation. So then I became an MEP in 2009. The Greens had tabled an amendment, 2008-2009. It said that Europe had put a lot of money into Chernobyl, the first sarcophagus, and that we needed to help the victims. I took that amendment and I went to DG Energy in the Commission. And I said, you're helping the victims, but you're helping the victims by carrying out research, but you're not helping the victims there on the ground where they live. And together with Yuri Bozensky, we were able to release 4 million euros to renovate a hospital in Ivankov in the contaminated zone. There are still millions of people who are living in the contaminated zone, and we were able to help the children renovate the hospital, put gamma meters in place, carry out analyses of all of the foodstuffs. We set up a greenhouse so that people could get safe food. We put in place an incinerator so that wood could be burned rather than contaminate the surrounding area. This was thanks to the Commission. At the beginning, it was 600 million euros for the sarcophagus. Now you know it's more than 1.5 billion for the second. And then there's the additional cost of storage. But 4 million euros were then set aside to help the victims. So it was important for the Greens to work on this. And I've looked at all of the research which has been funded by Europe, 60 million euros of funding, and then by the Germans, by the Japanese, by the English, by the French. If you look at that research, there's no information about the exact health effects in the Ukraine, in Belarus, despite all that research that's been done. So I was very pleased to see research commissioned by Rebecca in 2006, which is now going to tell us something about the health impact. because the research came from biologists and doctors and physicists. If you look at the research done by Europe, you see commissioners for nuclear energy, Areva, EDF. You find people who defend nuclear power. That's their stance. Now I go to the UN, I go to the International Atomic Energy Agency and the International Commission for Radiological Protection. I look at their reports and they say, well, Chernobyl, there were 30 deaths at the beginning, then there were 56. And then we're told, oh yes, well, 6,000 people affected by thyroid cancer. But, oh well, you can manage a nuclear accident. And that's all lies. These are people who are influenced by the nuclear lobby. So you can see that in this area, when it comes to the research done on the accident and the witness statements, you can hear that there has been an effort to block access to information. That's why it's so important to commission research on the health impact. 30 years later in Ivankov, you can see that 80% of the children are ill. Some of them have heart problems. Some of them are anemic. They can't play sport like other children. And they're now into the third generation. This is not the first generation that was there when Chernobyl took place. So we really do need to push for independent research. And that's why in the Greens, we're very tough on this, because we don't want to see more accidents. We don't want to see more accidents. We need to move away from nuclear. Now, I'm going to give the floor to Mr. Ian Fairley. He's a biologist who specializes in radio protection, and he's carried out some research on the health impacts from the legacy of Chernobyl. You have the floor.
Ça marche? First of all, thank you very much to Rebecca for organizing this, this symposium. It's very good indeed. I want to make a couple of preliminary comments because I am perhaps the only British speaker here. And that is that many people think that Britain is a weird country and it's going to leave the European Union. I want to tell you here that there are many people in Britain who strongly believe that we should be a part of Europe, okay?
Yeah.
The second thing is that, like Rebecca and Jo Leinen, I am a veteran. My first nuclear demonstration that I went on was 1978. So I've been around for a long time. However, I'm also a scientist. In fact, I worked for the British government for 10 years, up to 2004, advising the British government on radiation protection matters. It was only when I reached retirement age that I left the employment of the British government. My main message, I suppose, today is that is to tell you that from a scientific point of view, that was looking at the published evidence, peer-reviewed evidence, that the effects of Chernobyl are very serious, very widespread, and continuing today. In a word, they are devastating, and they are still devastating, and they will continue to be devastating for our lifetimes. It's true that we are now 30 years after the event, and I've just been speaking to some journalists who the first question they asked me is, oh, or 30 years later, everything's fine, surely. No. 30 years later, and it's still continuing. And you can see the surprise in some journalists' faces when they realize that, contrary to what they've been fed by the nuclear industry, that the matter is very serious indeed. Now, everything that I say is actually published in a report called Torch 2016. Torch is an acronym standing for the other report on Chernobyl, which was started 10 years ago, funded by Rebecca, for which many, many thanks. This new report is actually funded by the city government of Vienna, and we should thank them very much too. And I'd like to point out the person who commissioned this, and his name is Reinhold Ulrich, and he is sitting right here. Would you stand up, please? This person commissioned the report. Thank you very much. Okay, we're going to move on now to the next slide. There's Chernobyl. This is what the IAEA said in 1996. It said it was the foremost nuclear catastrophe in human history. There you go. This is not me saying this or any government. This is the IAEA saying this, the International Atomic Energy Agency. 10 years later, the WHO and IAEA said that the magnitude and scope and size of the affected populations and its long-term consequences make Chernobyl the worst industrial disaster on record. Again, in other words, these are official comments. Basically, you don't have to say anything anymore. You don't have to argue with anybody. You just say, this is what they say. Next one. This is a map of the cesium-137 contamination made by the European Commission in 1996 to 1998, showing the huge amounts of contamination throughout the whole of Europe. And we can see, yes, as Michel Ravazzi has pointed out, yes, the cloud certainly did go into France, despite the French government saying, no, vous pouvez pas entrer. By the way, you may think I'm making fun of the French. Exactly the same thing happened in England as well. The British government couldn't believe that this would happen. But it did. And we can see here quite a lot of contamination in the west coast of the UK. In fact, there's quite a bit of irony here. Does anybody know here where most of the Chernobyl contamination landed in England? Well, let me tell you, Sellafield. And Sellafield is a place where there's a huge amount of contamination anyway from the reprocessing of nuclear fuel, which happens there. I want to mention something about this map. It's very important. We need to keep this map, and we need to pass it on to future generations. Why? Because the IAEA and the WHO and UNSCEAR and national governments never refer to this map. This is one of the few occasions where you can actually see it. When it was published back in 1998, it was in a very low-key publication in the European Commission, very difficult to find, and now no longer exists. So I've managed to find it by using old registrations. And what makes it really terrible is the fact that the 400,000 data points upon which this map is based have been lost by the European Commission. This is a scientific crime, in my view. In other words, all we've got now is the map. We don't have the data. So it's vital that we keep this map and we pass it on to future generations. It's all that we've got. Next map. Now, the previous map I showed you was cesium-137. This is iodine contamination. Iodine is important because iodine is concentrated in the thyroid gland, and that results in thyroid cancers. And have we seen thyroid cancers? You betcha. We've seen a lot of thyroid cancers throughout Europe. Now, this map is quite interesting because it shows you that in Central Europe, there was a great deal of iodine deposition, particularly in Austria and in the Czech Republic. And indeed, it was because Friends of the Earth in Austria knew that this was, had anecdotal reports about this, that it commissioned me to do a special chapter on Austria. And indeed, we do, I'll show you in a minute, we do find thyroid cancers in Austria. One of the things about iodine is that it's not just, this is particulate iodine, by the way, and it's iodine which deposits on dust particles. But iodine also exists as a gas, iodine gas, and also as an organic form, methyl iodide too. These are not only radioactive poisons, but they are chemical poisons. And large amounts of it were smeared, as you can see here, across Western Europe. Next one. This is the official data from UNSCEAR 2008. UNSCEAR stands for United Nations Scientific Committee on the Effects of Atomic Radiation. This shows you the number, horrific numbers of people who were affected and still remain affected by Chernobyl. You will see that some of the numbers slightly differ from the previous accounts that have been heard this morning. Different people use different registers. I go by what they say, and they say these numbers. In other words, 500,000 liquidators, cleanup workers, about 130,000 evacuees, about 6 million people living in highly contaminated areas in Belarus, Ukraine, and Russia. Ah, that's terrible. 6.5 million people still living in contaminated areas, still eating contaminated food. If you look at those people living in low contaminated areas, by below I mean below 40 kilobags per square meter, then square kilometer, there are 500 million people still living in those areas. And if you add the whole total up, we're talking about 600 million. These are mind-boggling numbers. They make you wince to see these numbers. They make you wince when, after you read the numbers, you realize that a number of governments still want to build nuclear power stations, including the government which is in the United Kingdom. I hesitate to say my government. It's not my government. It just happens to be the government, the administration in power right now. This is a serious matter. Next slide. The headline figures for the number of expected fatal cancers are as follows. From the Torch report here, I estimate that over the next 50 years or so, there will be 40,000 excess fatal cancers due to Chernobyl. And you may think this is a far too high a figure. Surprising? Well, it's not. It's consistent with previous estimates, and which are up on the board as well. What do we mean by that, and how do we get the figures? Well, using official data, we know that the collective dose from Chernobyl is about 400,000 person-sievers. I'll repeat that, 400,000. The risk estimate is 10% of that, 10% per siever, so we get 40,000. There's a bit of uncertainty here, but at the same time, we know that within a ballpark figure, that these figures are correct. They're scientifically established figures. Next one. Go on. These are the main effects from Chernobyl. Go on. You may say, well, why thyroid cancers and why leukemias? Well, the reason why they, in particular, though, is because bone marrow and thyroid glands are highly radiosensitive, particularly in children. So you only need a little bit of radioactivity or radiation to cause big effects in the thyroid. And so there are large numbers of, epidemics of thyroid cancer in Belarus and Ukraine. And also now we're beginning to see epidemics of leukemias in those countries as well. But it's not just cancers, it's cardiovascular diseases and strokes, birth defects, and a lot, I'll come to this in a minute, ill health amongst children in particular. A lot of breathing difficulties and colds, flus, bronchitis, which are very difficult to measure. One of the astonishing things that's coming out of the report is that many people think, well, radiation, it's cancer. Well, no, it's cancer and cardiovascular. The two are level pegging. If you get 10 cancers, you're going to have 10 cases of cardiovascular diseases or strokes. Strokes is really bad. By the way, you know what a stroke is? A stroke is when you have a blood clot which affects your brain and you fall down, basically, because your brain doesn't get enough oxygen. Strokes are very fatal, very often fatal. So it's a serious health effect. And what I'm saying to you is that the effects of radiation are equal between cancer and cardiovascular, plus strokes. Next one. Sarah, next one. I'm going to talk about thyroid cancer. By the way, these pictures are the least distressing ones that I could find. These father and son here have both had thyroidectomies. Go on. This shows you the number of thyroid cancer cases in Belarus. This is 1986, where the accident took place. And 4 years later, which 4 years is the latency period for thyroid cancer, we can see these big increases. The top two are women, and the bottom two are men. Thyroid cancer is much more prevalent amongst women, about 3 to 4 times more than men. And the reason why is because women have much larger endocrine systems than men do. So this is a woman's issue. And I'm glad to see that there are many women in this audience. It's a matter, and the countries affected, Belarus, Ukraine, and Russia, it's a disaster amongst the women. It really is. And I feel, you know, quite affected by it. Next slide. A question that many people ask me as a scientist, well, okay, there's these big risks of thyroid cancer. Well, how big are the risks? Well, in layman's language, we see 700% increases over the background rate. These are huge increases. In fact, as I say here, they are the biggest increases in risk ever measured after exposures to a toxic substance. I'll repeat that. These are the biggest risks I've ever seen. 700% increase. Normally, in the work that I do, I expect 20, 30%. 700%? Another way of saying, by the way, 700% means sevenfold increase. Well, that's why we're seeing so many thyroid cancers in Belarus and Ukraine. Big epidemics in both countries. Next slide. And it's not just Belarus and Ukraine, but also Austria. And what we can see here is that, if I can point to here, this is 1986 is here. That's when the Chernobyl took place. And 4 years later, the latency period for thyroid cancer, we see increases going up, and they're still increasing now. This is up to 2012. You may say, why are these increases occurring? Well, I would say that between 10 and 40% of the reason for this increase is due to Chernobyl. There are other reasons that we don't know why, but thyroid cancers are increasing throughout the world, and we're not really sure why. I think it's a scandal. I think we should spend a lot more time and effort and money trying to find out why these increases are occurring. But it's every country in the world, the thyroid cancers are increasing. But in Ukraine and also in Belarus and now in Austria, the increases are bigger than normal. Go on. And the reason why, this is a map of of iodine concentrations in Austria. Now, it's not very clear, but I'll show you the outline of the country of Austria with my red pen. It goes here, up here, and right here. Okay? That's the country of Austria. And you can see that here, this in the purple square, the concentrations of iodine particulate was very high, and that is the region of Vienna. So Vienna, in colloquial language, Vienna got it. Why? Because the rainfall that occurred. And since I spoke at a conference in Vienna about a week and a half ago. And since returning to England, I've spoken to people who were in Vienna at the time. And they tell me that it poured about April the 30th and May the 6th were the two dates of the big depositions. This is cumulative. And it was raining very heavily. Another woman told me who worked, of course, Vienna is the world headquarters for the IAEA, okay? And a woman who was working there as a typist back in 1986, we don't remember it, but people still had typists then. You didn't have laptops or computers. You had to have secretaries. And she was an employee of IAEA and the United Nations buildings in Vienna. And she was playing tennis along with a number of her colleagues also who worked at IAEA. And in the afternoon of April the 30th, and suddenly a number of officials came rushing out of the building saying, get inside, stop playing tennis, get inside. And so they had to stop playing, leave their rackets and run into the building. And she remembers that. And she had to stay in the building the whole night. By the way, that was for because the IAEA officials knew what was going on. That information was not transmitted to Vienna. And so Vienna went by along its normal business without unaware of what was going on. This is the kind of nonsense and double standards that go on amongst the nuclear community. I'm afraid I don't like it at all. Next slide. If we look at, it's not just, by the way, Vienna or Austria. We also see increases in the Czech Republic, north in England, and north of England, and Slovakia, and Finland as well. However, the authorities aren't very keen about looking at these other countries because they're in the West. And they like to maintain the polite fiction that Chernobyl only affected Belarus, Ukraine, and Russia. No, it didn't. It affected the whole of Western Europe. Next slide. For example, here we go for, this is the rise in thyroid cancer in the Czech Republic. Does it remind you of the previous slide? Yes, it does. It's almost identical to the one in Austria. Go on, next slide. So how many excess cases will occur? Well, already we've measured 6,000 excess cases of thyroid cancer. That's an epidemic by, in anyone's definition. And we expect about another 16,000 cases over the next 30, 40 years. Now, remember, this was for exposures which took place between April the 30th and May the 8th, 1986. Iodine-131 has got a half-life of 8.3 days, so that means it rapidly decays. Within a couple of weeks, it's all gone. Within a month or two, it's all gone. So these were exposures which only lasted, as I say, a few weeks. And here we are 30 years later, and people are still experiencing thyroid cancers. What, you'll say? Even today, when people who were exposed as children back in 1986, they're now developing thyroid cancer? Yes, that's exactly what's happening. Well, how long is this going to continue? For as long as they live. I'll give you an example. Back in 1945, when the atomic bombs were dropped in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, there are still children who were exposed then, who are now, of course, you know, 65, 70, 80 years old, who are dying from thyroid cancer now. In England, we have a phrase, the gift that keeps on giving. Well, here we've got the poison that keeps on poisoning. In other words, these effects will continue to arise over our lifetime and the lifetime of our children and grandchildren. Next slide. Leukemia. That's all, by the way, just thyroid cancer. Now on to leukemia. Next slide. We can see big increases again, what I would call epidemics, in Russian workers, Ukrainian workers, and also increases in and leukemia in Finland, Slovakia, Germany, Greece, and Italy. These are from cesium exposures, by the way, okay? Leukemia arises from exposures to the bone marrow. But we can see 500% increases amongst the Russian workers. Oh, geez, that's terrible. Amongst Ukrainian workers, about 240% increases. These are slightly lower than thyroid cancer increases, but still very, very high indeed. Next slide. And also we're seeing increases in solid cancers, for example, cancers of the bladder, colon, lung, kidney, and stomach. Smaller increases, but still we're seeing increases. These increases are all statistically significant. In other words, they're real increases. Go on. These are the increases in cardiovascular disease. Next slide. Go back to the previous slide. Can you do that? Yes. Many people say that the effects of radiation are very, with nothing to worry about. They say that the doses below 100 millisieverts don't exist. Well, in this slide here, there are three data points below 100 millisieverts showing effects. And these are huge numbers, by the way, showing that, in fact, there are effects of radiation, even at very low doses. Again, this is not cancer. This is cardiovascular diseases. Go on, next slide. Birth defects. Go on. We are now seeing very definite evidence of birth defects. All birth defects, sorry, here, 7% increase, and nervous system defects, 45% increase. What do I mean by nervous system? I'm talking about neural tube defects during embryonic development. We're seeing when the children are actually, these embryos are actually born, fetuses are born, there's a 45% increase over what you would expect to have seen. This is hard evidence showing birth defects. These are teratogenic effects. In other words, effects in utero. Many people will remember back in the 1980s and 1990s, thalidomide, which resulted in babies born without arms and legs, etc. This is radiation effects and causing birth defects and nervous system birth defects in women who were pregnant at the time of the accident back in 1986. Next slide. There's also another study, another defect. Well, it is. Down syndrome is a birth defect, trisomy 21. And we see increased Down syndrome in all of these countries. However, the authorities choose to look the other way and refuse to acknowledge the fact that there's a consistent pattern of Down syndrome, by the way, for those who used to be called Mongolism. Basically, it's a birth defect, and we're now, many studies were done by scientists who were really concerned. You can see the dates of these, they're quite old. And it was only because I saw a study by Zetzepin from 2007 that I went back and looked, and lo and behold, hey, there were lots of studies which the authorities have conveniently overlooked. So I think it's quite clear to say that Down syndrome is a recognized effect from Chernobyl. Next slide. And this one is one which affects me and affects my partner Jane most of all, and that is persistent health in the children. Go on. We're seeing impaired lung function, difficulties in breathing, decreased blood counts, higher immunoglobulin factors. Immunoglobulin factors mean that there's a lot of inflammation, which is bad for you. Increased anemias and colds and flus. But by the way, these are all recent studies. They're all statistically significant studies. And
the one that really affects me is that if you actually increase the amount of clean food amongst children, you actually get improvements in health. What happened was about a study in Ukraine back in 1996. The Ukrainian government decided that they couldn't afford to keep on feeding children with three clean meals a day. It reduced it down to only two. But at the time, there was a big epidemiology study going on. And so they said, well, right, this is a laboratory in a way. We didn't expect this to happen, but we're going to do a before and after study. And lo and behold, the people who were only had two clean meals a day suddenly developed a whole... Suddenly developed a whole series of adverse effects. So the message is this, that those Chernobyl children's projects throughout the world, in Germany and Britain, Canada and United States, who take tens of thousands of children and give them radioactivity-free holidays, in other words, and being able to eat clean food and clean water, it is of measurable improvement, contrary to what I was told when I did my studies. We should support Chernobyl children's projects. I'd like to point out someone here, Linda Walker. Would you stand up, please? Linda is chairman of UK Chernobyl Children's Projects. Okay, next slide, very quickly. For those people who want Chernobyl in a nutshell, there it is. 5 million people still affected badly, 500 million in less contaminated areas. I'll skip to the next slide. Chair, I'd like to, 30 seconds to do a comparison of Chernobyl and Fukushima, yeah? Because I'm asked this question very often, so I might as well deal with it now. Many people think that Fukushima is very serious. It is very serious indeed. But Chernobyl is at least 10 times more serious. If you look at the right-hand column, you'll see the difference between, in terms of area contaminated, Chernobyl is about 50 times greater. If you look at the cesium source term, about 7 times greater, iodine, 12 times greater. If you look at the collective dose, which perhaps is the most important, because you're looking at people here and their doses, it's about 8 times greater. Thyroid gland doses, collective dose, 20 times greater. The number of people living in contaminated areas, and et cetera, et cetera. So the ballpark figure is 10 times greater. Next slide. I would like to conclude by saying that nuclear power is a supremely unforgiving technology. In other words, if anything goes wrong, it has a propensity to go very, very wrong. 6 million people living in contaminated areas and contamination over 600,000 square kilometers in Europe. That's pretty grim. Millions are still living in contaminated areas. Health effects are still occurring. And there is a need for more humanity towards the affected people in Ukraine and Belarus and Russia. There really is. Next slide. I'm finishing, Chairman, on a slide of the two prime ministers or leaders of the countries who were in power at the time of their accidents. On the left is Naoto Kan, the Prime Minister of Japan, and on the right is Mikhail Gorbachev. Both of them now campaign strongly against nuclear power, and both of them say that we shouldn't really have more nuclear power stations. I strongly applaud their stance. I think that's it.
Moi, je vous remercie beaucoup pour...
Would I like to thank you for all that information. We can see that Chernobyl still continues to affect us. Now, those two prime ministers have become anti-nuclear advocates because they saw that, they bore witness to that. And this is why it's important for you to be here today. You've got all of this information at your disposal, and now you have to bear witness to this. You have to promote long-term, lifelong, sustainable energies, renewable energies. So now we can move on to our next round table. Our moderator is going to be Brunis Ruppe. It's you. Oh, it's Rebecca instead, who's going to replace him. And this is going to be on security and safety of nuclear reactors today.
So thank you again also from my side, Dr. Ian Fairley. It's, I think, again and again, very important to have also this cooperation in between politics and science, because what I experience in my work on Chernobyl and also meanwhile on Fukushima is that there is enough knowledge because science is developing, but the bridge in between science and politics is not strong enough so far, and the bridge from industry and the bridge on economic interests in all those issues to politics is much more developed and much more stable than this bridge in between politics and science. For the next panel, we have invited speakers from Lithuania, from Belarusia, and from Ukraine. It is this part of our conference in which we deal with the situation of nuclear industry, especially in the east of the European Union. I think as kind of a positive orientation, I would like to point out a very interesting fact. This is that since the Fukushima accident in 1986, in the European Union, we saw only two new builds starting. So this is, I think, a self-explaining figure on the campaign or against the campaign from nuclear industry, that there is a renaissance of nuclear power. Is not. And so we from the nuclear anti-nuclear movement, anti-nuclear politicians are organizing themselves well, we can achieve in Europe a final breakthrough against nuclear, but we have to do it. And the people sitting here on this panel, they are not only experts on the nuclear situation in their countries, they are also, I think, dedicated to this idea. We start now with Tatiana Novikova, from Belarusia, and she brings us from her country. I would say it is the country, probably as a country, suffering most from the consequences of Chernobyl. She brings us so messages to this conference, how we shall continue to follow also the situation in Belarusia. Please.
It's video message.
I did not know. I mixed the two persons, yeah. So this is not Tatiana, but Tatiana is now for you visible on the video screen. Can you restart it? Because everybody obviously must use the headphones.
There is no sound coming into the interpretation booths.
Also, there will be another try. Now we start with Irina. She represents the organization Echo Home and is one of the very, very brave Belarusian anti-nuclear activists.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this opportunity to speak before you. I'm going to speak about those risks that have come about because of Belarus's decision to build an NPP. Despite Belarus having suffered more than any other country, and before this, prior to this, we didn't have a single NPP, our government took the decision to go ahead with the construction. And in my presentation, I would like to talk to you about the risks that this project carries for Europe, including Belarus and the rest of Europe, obviously, the bigger Europe, and about the facts of violations, cases of violations during the implementation of the project, and to what extent transparency for there is transparency for the public, for the international structures, conventions, what's happening to the project, and how environmental organizations see possible solutions.
Have a problem. There is a technical interference with the microphone, and it's probably because of the video screening. Okay. Now it's better, and I think you should restart. Sorry, technology.
Еще раз. So once again, I would like to talk to you today about the risks that the project carries with itself, that the Ostrovetsk NPP. And in the context with the situation, I would like to talk to you about the risks from this NPP for Belarus and for neighboring countries, and the cases of violations of the legislation, of international conventions, and how these violations are related to risks that the project carries, and what solutions environmental organizations could find. What is the connection between risks and risks that emanate from the construction of an NPP and violations? From our point of view, there's a direct link. When there's a violation of procedures, technologies, when there's a violation of the rationale of the construction process, risks of technical incidents increase. And when human rights are violated, when the public is deprived of its right to take part in the decision-making process, and when the transparency of the project is reduced, this carries additional risks in the process of, or rather after the project is completed. There are then risks of potential incidents. The whole thing started with, from the very beginning, from the selection of the venue, of the location of the NPP. This Austerlitz NPP will be located on the boundary with Lithuania, 20 kilometers from the border, and about 45 kilometers from Vilnius. When the site was being selected, there were a number of violations of the Belarusian standards. The selection was completed before all the studies were done. The site was selected without any participation of the public or any consultation with the public, and it was selected before there were any consultations with, or rather, any consultations on the ESPO convention. This site was selected in a region where there is a danger of earthquakes. In the previous century, there was an earthquake in this region. The next thing we have noted is that in the environmental assessment, the risks and dangers were diminished. Those risks and dangers that could occur as a result of an incident. In the environmental assessment, it says that the potential effect would be limited to the 4 kilometer wide area around the NPP. This is laughable after the Chernobyl experience, actually. I think this is irresponsible, because it goes to show that the lessons of Chernobyl have not been learned. And if you look at these maps, you will see forecasts made by Austrian organizations, research organization FlexRisk. They have calculated various possible scenarios in case of a serious incident at the NPP, and you can see, well, it's a little bit far and you might struggle to see, but when you see this reddish-purple area, it's a settlement area, and we know that there would be a danger for Lithuania. We know that the country is divided into two parts, and Vilnius would have to be evacuated. In case of a serious scenario, there could be an area of 300 kilometers, depending on the direction of the wind. But you can see that Europe could actually be affected by a high dose of radionuclides in this case. And if we're talking about unaffected area of 4 kilometers, then we do not understand, we are not aware of all of the possible dangers. It caused a lot of concern because this project has not been adequately assessed. This is another example from the environmental assessment where it says that the protective area of the reactor could withstand an air crash of a plane that is over 5,000 tons, 5.7 tons. And you can see a possible scenario when a plane is flying over the site to land at the Minsk airport. This is an important air corridor with a lot of large aircraft flying, over. And perhaps I don't need to remind anyone that today, when we live in the age of terrorist attacks, I don't need to remind anyone how dangerous this could be. The construction of the Belarus NPP started before any consultation with the public. The site was being prepared as early as 2010, and the first hearings were held in 2009. This started even before there were any consultations with the countries that could be affected by this project according to the ESPO convention procedures. In 2014, there was an inspection by Gosatomnadzor, and they have identified a number of violations related to equipment, production of concrete structures, or construction of the concrete structures, and other aspects. And here I can show you an example of what can happen at nuclear facilities that Rosatom builds. You can see here a very heavy metal construction failing. This is the construction of Leningrad NPP. I don't have a lot of time, and so I'll just say a couple of words. The Aarhus Convention, the ESPO Convention, and compliance committees have recognized that Belarus has violated both conventions in the process of the implementation of this project, and so far Belarus has not resolved the issue with the Lithuanian Republic. In the context of the ESPO convention, Lithuania is obviously extremely concerned. This facility is located very close to the Lithuanian border. It's dangerously close to the capital of Lithuania. As far as the discussion is concerned, very quickly, this project had not been discussed with Belarus in accordance with the Aarhus Convention, when this is supposed to be discussed at the very early stages, before a principal decision is taken, before a site is selected. Nothing has been done, and the compliance committee of the Aarhus Convention has recognized that. And currently, Belarus has received recommendations from the committee to improve its legislation, and actually, in fact, our authorities are moving towards implementing these recommendations, although the compliance committee is hearing a case about the prosecution of anti-nuclear activists in Belarus. And we hope very much that those positive changes that have started in our country in the context of the recommendations on the Aarhus Convention, and we hope that the ESPO Convention's recommendations will also be implemented. From our point of view, the construction of this NPP in Belarus should be suspended until such time as all consultations are completed and all necessary procedures under international conventions are observed. And we hope that the European Union, European countries will help Belarus, will motivate Belarus to take the right decisions and to implement implement these steps. Thank you.
We continue with the contribution. We continue with the contribution from the Lithuanian perspective to this nuclear power plant. Mr. Tomilinas is representing the party of Bronis Roppe. Bronis Roppe could not make it today to Brussels, but this party, who is a party to my Green Group in the European Parliament, is very engaged from the Lithuanian side in this work against the new construction, the new build in Belarusia. And so close to the Chernobyl anniversary, we will be in the region together, Brunes and me, and we will continue what we are starting to discuss here. Please, Tommy.
Thank you, Rebecca. My name is Thomas. Hello, everybody. The issue of safety of nuclear energy is extremely important in my country and the whole region. Let me, in a few minutes, remind you the short history, not so long history. We have been a country with nuclear power plant, but when entering the European Union more than 10 years ago, it was the firm condition of European Union to close down the power, even more powerful reactor than in Chernobyl we had in Ignalina, and we did that, and now we are nuclear-free, nuclear energy production-free country as a direct consequence of strong political will of European Union, so to say, inspired by the tragedy of Chernobyl, as a direct consequence of Chernobyl. We were also working hard last 3 or 4 years on stopping the new project in our country that was planned to be performed with a reactor from Fukushima, and there was a referendum in my country in 2012 about the construction of the new nuclear power plant, and the people by the vast majority rejected the project of the government. And now even since the start of Ostravets, Belarusian nuclear power plant, we were construction. We were active at pushing our government to be very firm and strong on position against the Belarusian project, and we are developing a coalition of political parties in our country to bring a message to Belarus that we will not buy the electricity from Ostravets. We will work hard, we will do whatever we can to technically to be able to be independent from this electricity. For that we need very big support from European Union with synchronization of our networks with Europe. And I'm here just to remind you that Lithuania still feels lonely in this project, in this process, in this battle against the new Chernobyl just in front of my capital city, next to my capital city, 50 kilometers from my town, my city. What has already been done in European Parliament, and I just wanted to mention the last week signed letter by Green Group President Rebecca Harms, European Parliament members Claude Turmes and Bronis Rope to the Commission, to the European Union, to the European Commission President Juncker, where in this letter the members of Parliament requested the explanation what has been done by the Commission to investigate if Belarus has performed the nuclear stress test or not, because we have been hearing the message from the Commission very, very diverse and very different. Some of the members say that they did it, some that not. And this is not a serious situation. Commission should be much more serious on new Belarusian project, which is dangerous and risky. That's it.
So it's also to be underlined that for my group in the European Parliament, it's a gift that we have some few members, meanwhile, from Eastern European countries. And Bronis Rope, who could not be here today, is a very, very good colleague for me in this whole history of nuclear and also in the battle against it, because, and this makes him so interesting, he has been in his former life, before he came to the European Parliament, the mayor of Ignalina, and managed in Ignalina, in the city of Ignalina, to start the energy transition in a very, very impressive way. So it's a pity that Bronis could not make it, but we will continue this work in Lithuania and together with the friends and colleagues from Belarusia. Continue now, not with the video. I don't take the risk now. we try it in the end. But we continue with Irina Holovko from Ukraine. I work with Bankwatch, an NGO working with a special focus on energy, on nuclear, etc., in the east of Europe. I work with Bankwatch since decades, and Irina, since long, is the pillar of this work in Ukraine. Please, Irina.
Thank you, Rebecca, very much for this opportunity to be here today and for having this floor to basically present the overview of the nuclear energy in Ukraine now, 30 years after Chernobyl. From the other side, I'm sorry for not being able to give you any good news on this. As to the fact is that now, 30 years after Chernobyl, Ukraine is still very heavily dependent on nuclear energy. And the worst thing is that there are further plans to still keep this reliance, and basically there is no debate in the country as to the possibilities and the need to think about a gradual phase-out. I'd say that there are five main things which are very important to remember about the nuclear energy in Ukraine. And first of all is that over half of the electricity that is generated in Ukraine now is being generated by four nuclear power plants, where we have altogether 15 nuclear reactors. Can you please show the map? Yeah, thanks. 12 out of these 15 units are reaching the end of their initially designed lifetime within this decade. So by 2020, 12 of these 15 reactors are reaching the end of initially designed lifetime. And four of them already operate beyond projected lifetime. The third thing is that all of the reactors we currently operate, they are of the Russian, of the Soviet design, and each and single one of them is operating on the Russian fuel still. There are some attempts to diversify the supplies. These attempts are ongoing. But the fact is still here. All of the units need Russian fuel to run. Otherwise, they will not be able to run. And fact number four is that the biggest nuclear power plant, the biggest in Europe, actually, nuclear power plant, which is Zaporizhzhia NPP, is about 260 kilometers away from the front line, from the conflict zone in the East Ukraine. And we have six units in operation over there, plus the on-surface storage for the spent nuclear fuel also on that particular site. The fact number five is that there is actually a direct European support to the plans of European Ukrainian government to keep the units in operation and to keep reliance on the nuclear power. And this support comes in the form of loans, in form of two loans, one from European Bank of Reconstruction and Development, the EBRD, and the second one from European Commission, let's say, because it's from the Euratom loan facility. So we have the 600 million euro support coming to so-called safety upgrade program. This program covers the safety modernizations at all of the 15 nuclear units that is now in operations. So as you see, there are issues both of the safety, what we call nuclear safety, and there are also issues of the security. The security in two aspects. One aspect is the physical security and protection of the nuclear power plant in the country when there is basically a war ongoing. And the second one is the security of the supply of the electricity, because the situation when you have more than half of the electricity in the country being produced at only four plants, it is very vulnerable, and we already seen to what it can lead. For I cannot help but remembering the situation back in December 2014 when we had the incident at one of the units at Zaporizhzhia nuclear power plant, and you probably all heard about it because it was in news all over Europe that there was accident in Zaporizhzhia NPP. Also, it wasn't an accident at that time of the big scale, but the unit was shut down. And because only this one unit covered about 4% of the whole electricity in the country, there were massive blackouts all around the country. So it's a big issue of how sustainable the system is when you have such a huge over-reliance on four power plants. From the safety perspective of these reactors, the reactor fleet in Ukraine is aging. We inherited 12 out of 15 units from Soviet time. Their lifetime is coming to an end. You know that safety modernizations can fix some of the issues, but of course there are parts in the units, such as reactor pressure vessel, that cannot be replaced. And it very much depends on the state of this equipment, such as reactor pressure vessel, whether it is safe or not safe to operate the units further on. The second point is that there is, of course, the list of safety measures that was identified and required by the state nuclear regulator, also the post-Fukushima measures that were identified during the stress tests. And unfortunately, what we observe as monitoring the situation in Ukraine is that these safety upgrade measures are not being implemented on time fully and are postponed for years. Positive decisions allowing expired units at South Ukrainian nuclear power plant to restart back in 2013 and 2015, we concerned that these decisions were taken despite the fact that the number of safety upgrade measures were not implemented fully, even the measures of the highest priority, or they were implemented but not reported and not verified properly by the nuclear safety authority in the country. international donors, of course, provide a lot of support to Ukraine. We talked today about the support that European Union is providing to the fighting the consequences of the Chernobyl accident. But not many people know, also in Brussels, that that there is a European support to kind of keeping this reliance on nuclear energy in Ukraine still there. This 600 million loans that I've been mentioning before, this about a quarter of all the financial support from the European Union to Ukrainian energy sector over the last period of 7 years between 2007 and 2014. So it's a big portion of support that is being channeled from European public funds to Ukrainian government to keep this reliance on nuclear. It is also not very pleasant for me now to say that despite the signed guarantee agreements between the European Commission and the Ukraine, Ukrainian government in December, in September, I'm sorry, 2015, just simply by the decree moved the deadline for the implementation of safety upgrade program for the operating nuclear units for another 3 years, so from December 2017 to December 2020. And as far as we informed, because we asked both the European Commission and the EBRD whether they were consulted, whether they did approve this postponement of the deadline, the answer was no. So officially, they were not consulted and not even merely informed of the fact that this postponement is being approved by the Ukrainian government. It is yet to be seen if this new deadline will be kept, and we believe that it will depend very much upon the leverage that European Union institutions and the EBRD will be ready and willing to apply to ensure that this, at least this amount of some safety measures that can improve a little bit the safety of all those aging units are implemented within the deadlines that are being set. If we have a couple of more minutes, I would like to mention also the security risks. And of course, it is very difficult to assess how big are the risks of terroristic actions toward our nuclear power plants, Zaporizhzhia in particular, but it is definitely an increased risk, and it is definitely a concern, and also a concern for the public and for the workers at the power plant, for those who manage the power plant. This is what we've been hearing from them directly on our fact-finding mission in April last year, and I believe it still is the concern for them. The power plants, the nuclear power plants, were not designed to operate in the times of the war, of any armed conflict, doesn't matter how we, what type of war, right? I already talked about the fact that in the case of emergency shutdown, it's of one of the units, the system is very vulnerable, and the blackouts is something that we are already facing sometime. And this is all particularly important of the because as I mentioned, we are totally dependent on Russia with the fresh nuclear fuel. It is not possible to have a big stock of the fuel near the plants, so we have to renew the fresh nuclear fuel quite often. If I'm not mistaken, once in 2 years, we have to expect the new supply. And there is no guarantees that we're going to be having them, these supplies. So whatever the rhetorics that is being pushed by our government and by Energoatom that the nuclear power is our only way to become independent from Russia, minding the gas wars and other things, it is completely not true, because we are for now 100% dependent from Russia on the nuclear fuel. No fuel, the units will not be able to run, and we are in a very bad situation. So to briefly summarize the situation as it is, the current setup in Ukrainian electricity sector is risky and not sustainable and very vulnerable, due to the high safety risk and due to the high security risk, also the security of supplies. And we the public, the government, whatever stakeholders are in this process, we should really work towards changing the situation, towards decreasing the reliance on nuclear power. And this can be reached, ensured by the fact that we decentralize our generation. We do not rely on four nuclear power plants around the country. And decentralization, first of all, means that we develop, and decentralization and independence, of course, that we develop the domestic renewable energy resources. We do have enough potential, it just we lack the political will to look at those seriously. And, of course, the utilization of our potential in increasing efficiency of energy use in all sectors. And this is particularly where we see that the European support would be of the biggest value. As I say, the results of the studies that we had on where the European money goes in Ukrainian energy sector, and we were not very pleased to see that the quarter went to nuclear, and the big portion of other went also to support the gas sector, and only 15% went to energy efficiency and new renewables development. So this is one of the messages I would like to convey today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Irina, and I take the message. I knew it before. I think that the best thing we can do is to continue our pressure, not only so in Kiev, asking the government to finally also take responsibility, more responsibility in this context, but also to increase the pressure in Brussels, because it's really a scandal that much money goes to the purpose of lifetime extension of very old nuclear power plants. I know that it's difficult to develop the alternatives. I have my own experience from this process in Germany and in other countries, but at a certain point you have to admit that only prolonging the risks, the high risks in those old power plants, is not a sustainable strategy. The real problem behind this, that in the European Commission, there are also people who think that for the future energy strategy of European Union, lifetime extension of old reactors in the European Union is also the best concept. So we have a lot of things to do. I thank the podium, the panel right now, for your contribution, and ask my colleague Sirpa Pitikainen. We are running out of time with our translators. This is the problem. We do the video at the very end, but I now ask my colleague Sirpa Pitikainen to speak to us. Yeah? Sorry for this. Sirpa.
Thank you, and first of all, I apologize the ungrateful role what I have to cut down your discussions, but hope that you could continue it during the lunch session and afterwards too. Plus, I hope that we would create that kind of a network of information and contacts that we could continue the discussion. Firstly, I would like to thanks very much my good colleague Rebecca Harms, who has been very active on organizing this event and on the debate about the role of the nuclear in general, and of course all people who made this session possible and came here and witnessed what is the case. Very briefly, I would only have a couple of points on why this event is so important and the debate is so important. We have a concept about black swans, and this is how we perceive the risk. So we quite often overestimate the risk that is near and familiar. You grab the hand of your friend if they are trying to pass the street and the car is coming. Please do not go, you might be in a risk of having an accident. And the likelihood is very big that the car would stop and that there wouldn't be an accident. And that if the accident would be, it would be only very mild. But this is the accidents what we perceive. Then there are the big accidents that go beyond our understanding. And as psychologists have analyzed, we tend to overestimate the likelihood of a good risk. Who of you have tried to participate in lottery? So you think, yes, it could happen anyway. Well, someone somehow is going to get these 6 million or 60 million. So why not me? And the big mega risks, paradigm changing risks, are negative lotteries. And there we do not think, well, someone is going to have it. Someday it's going to happen. But you think, nah, really doesn't. Well, it wasn't so risky. Well, actually, it's a theory. And as you know, in the nuclear, there are many things. Actually, the waste disposal is far beyond solved. Tell me, who of you can say that you solved a problem with certainty for 10,000 years? And the costs, and this is the newest study by the Commission, are higher. They are double the ones that are estimated. And think of the accidents that were close to happen and happened in Fukushima, in Chernobyl. What did we learn? We should have learned that, yes, the accidents don't only may happen, but they happen. And they might be on that minute detrimental, or they are detrimental in the long term. And that's why I find it so important that the legacy of Chernobyl and the health aspect is debated. When you don't have hundreds and thousands of people dying immediately like this, you tend to forget and underestimate the cancers, the malinformations, the overlapping impacts what you have with chemicalization, the all that. And this is the risk and legacy we are putting to those people and their children who didn't have a say of the process. And think of the economic consequences. What is happening now in Ukraine, in Chernobyl? Think of if you could have used that place in economic sustainable way. Think of in Fukushima the next 30 years. What are the medical costs? What is the risk you are posing to human beings? And what is the economic long-term cost? So why we are prepared to take that? Why? And why we are prepared to extend the usability of old and hazardous nuclear power plants? And why in some of the countries like mine, we are even building the new ones and planning that this is the future choice of the energy? It's as bad as coal. It's as risky. And this is with as strong certainty. And I won't go in detail because you debated it already. We have a safe, understandable choice with multiple benefits. Save the energy, use it more effectively, use renewables, use multiple sources, small scale that is easily scalable up and down and sort of fits with the energy efficiency targets. I'm saying that only the foolish stupidity of human beings would prevent us picking that choice and making the decision to continue with nuclear and forgetting the very dear lessons what we have learned. And I think it is not only our chance, it's our duty as human beings in all possible connections to bring up the message, to try to convince someone to do the same. We have to confront politicians day after day, and I'm convinced one day this message is going to get a breakthrough. And then it's not the one who threw the first brick on the Berlin Wall that made it. It's all the generations and people before who did the work. And so it's the work that you are doing that makes it possible for that person in one day to say, now we are going to end it. So thank you very much, and I hope the best spirit and conviction and strength on this work, and I hope I can stay in contact with you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, sorry, I was supposed to tell us to tell that after this we have the reception.
Not yet.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Sorry, we changed a bit the program, but thanks to our translators, we are now able to screen the short video from our friend in Belarusia, and afterwards we will have the short reception. Please, now the video.
Уважаемые дамы и господа.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for giving me the floor, and thank you for the opportunity to speak in front of the European Parliament on such a controversial issue for Belarus, Lithuania and other EU countries. And here I'm referring to the Belarus nuclear power plant construction. I'm not going to discuss the issue of whether Belarus needs this nuclear power plant, although the answer is pretty clear. Considering the situation when Belarus has yet not risen above the Chernobyl consequences, when we are in the wake of the Fukushima disaster, when a number of advanced countries are phasing out nuclear power and are in transition to clean renewable energy, it is obvious that Belarus does not need a nuclear power plant. We also have to realize also that a Belarusian NPP raises additional risks which are still underestimated for the whole of Europe. And this risk is growing bigger when terrorism has reared its ugly head again and are setting its sights on the NPP. I would also like to call the attention of the European Parliament to the issues of safety of the Belarus NPP in Ostrovets, because these issues are related to what we refer to Belarusian international obligations. These obligations bind the country to inform other countries on the risks of their NPP, and not just to report, but to reduce the risks. In other words, to do something that is needed, to invite an IAEA mission to conduct stress tests and to do everything that is needed in order to minimize the risks for the adjacent affected countries. Belarus officially states that its NPP fully complies with some international standards, but that is not true. At this juncture, the Belarusian authorities have not complied with any standards. They have not mitigated the risks. Nothing has been done to make this construction transparent to other countries. Belarus has not invited the IAEA mission to assess the construction site. The Skikmish mission wasn't there either. The consultations with Lithuania haven't been finished yet on the Ostrovetsk NPP. And there are other facts that show that Belarus still does not comply with any standards in accordance with international conventions when it comes to building its NPP. If we look at the ESPO convention or Aarhus convention that were taken vis-à-vis the NPP in Belarus, the decisions were made in June 2014, and these decisions confirmed that Belarus needs to undertake certain measures in order to overcome the violations. Belarus needs to reduce the risks of its NPP vis-à-vis other EU countries. Over the last 2 years, Belarus hasn't done anything to reduce the risks of the Ostrovetsk NPP. These risks are pretty high these days, and they are high vis-à-vis EU countries, and flex risk that was conducted by Austrian scientists show that should there be a heavy scale, large-scale incident, these countries like Lithuania, Norway, Poland, and others who are closer to Belarus, they will suffer from the consequences of that accident. That's why the risks are at the top of the agenda. And I would say that right now we have a really good window of opportunity in order to convince Belarus that Belarus needs to take certain measures, that Belarus needs to step forward to the EU states and deliver on its obligations in accordance with the Aarhus and ISPU conventions. So the IAEA mission should be invited to assess this site, because Belarus has chosen this site 20 kilometers from the Lithuanian border. And there had been no additional research and assessment of the site. Belarus has also started constructing its NPP before the documents were there in place. Belarus continues to build this NPP in an untransparent manner. And what is more, Belarus continues to violate the conventions. So now we are at the crossroads. Either we convince Belarus to stop this construction and start delivering on its convention obligations, or we should just acknowledge the situation as status quo and that this construction is going against the conventions. Thank you.
Извините, можно?
May I?
Республика Беларусь.
Republic of Belarus.
Ich würde nur gerne
Извините,
sagen,
но
ja,
я хотел
Sie
сказать, что
sprechen.
У Международного агентства по атомной энергии мнение иное, чем у этого выступления. 18
On the 18th, on the 20th of April.
I'll give you the floor in a moment.
Еще, я хотел бы ответить...
Could you please listen to me? Could you please listen to me? I'll give you the floor in a moment. But it's up to me to give you the floor. I'd like to say who you were listening to. You were listening to Tatiana Novikova. She's a mathematician from Belarus. She has looked into contamination models following the Chernobyl disaster, and she's now an activist against nuclear power in Belarus. She has been confronted with a lot of difficulties. If you'd like to comment on the video, then you can have a minute to do that, or a couple of minutes, but then we won't have any interpretation left. So then we'll have to carry on our conversation outside the conference.
So, first of all, I would like to reply to the MEP who expressed himself and then he left. He did his deed and then he left. It's very unpleasant when words are being taken out of a context and then interpreted in a special way. He said that our president said that this is the cheapest project. It's not true. We had a selection of the most advanced modern companies that apply the most advanced safety technologies. And we had selected the cheapest solution out of the best. It's a pity that at this conference you haven't foreseen a discussion, because Republic of Belarus can say quite a lot, including the medical consequences of the Chernobyl catastrophe. I heard Mr. Feli, and I'm a doctor, and I disagree with a number of his conclusions. We do not have highly contaminated territories where people would live, and food and the standards for the radionuclide content are higher than at the European Union.
Das Mikrofon ist aus. Ihr Mikro.
Your microphone is off.
Sie müssen das Mikrofon.
You need to use the microphone, otherwise you won't be interpreted.
Я приехал из Беларуси.
So I came from Belarus, from the department for liquidation of the consequences of Chernobyl catastrophe, the emergency ministry.
We carefully have chosen our speakers, but it's not the only conference on Chernobyl impact. There will be others. For example, you can meet me and also some of the experts in April in Kiev and in Minsk. Maybe it's an opportunity for you because, for example, Mr. Ferli will present his studies also in Kiev. I will be in a conference in Minsk the 23rd of April. And there are many possibilities to discuss. Right now, I have to close this conference because we have no more time with our translators. These are the limits of the European Parliament. We have already overdone what we had agreed with our translators. We can discuss bilaterally during the lunch reception outside. So thank you very much to everybody who contributed. Thank you. And please come and let's discuss outside.